Good evening. Welcome to Heart to Heart. I'm Dave Spector. With me tonight, the president of the Berks County Medical Society, Dr. Andy Waxler. And tonight, we're going to talk about some new topics that came up at the recent National Heart Association meeting in Dallas.
No, it's actually the American College of Cardiology meeting in Chicago, but same idea.
Okay.
Right church, wrong pew.
I got you. Go ahead. What new topics that would be of interest to our viewers or what's happening? Anything? Any new approvals on medications or new treatments? Or I know sometimes it'll come up there, but it's not approved yet. But if it comes up there, it's usually a positive sign.
Exactly. So the cardiologists, we have sort of two governing bodies. We have the American Heart Association and the American College of Cardiology. American Heart Association is much more involved in sort of education of the general public. And they're a wonderful society that Dave and I have been involved in for, well, like 15 years.
And then
longer.
So.
The American College of Cardiology is more sort of the parental sort of governing umbrella organization for us cardiologists. So I like to go every year to the American College of Cardiology national meeting, and it moves around. This year it was in Chicago, it was last week. And what I always tell my friends and family is watch the news every night because that's when the big announcements were. So there were a few interesting things that came up last week in Chicago. The first thing that's kind of interesting is TAVR, T-A-V-R. We've talked about that before on this show. Basically what TAVR is, it stands for transvascular aortic valve replacement, transcatheter aortic valve replacement, that's what. It's a way to actually change a valve, put in a new valve in somebody who has what's called aortic stenosis. We've talked about aortic stenosis in the past. Aortic stenosis means we all have a valve called the aortic valve, and that valve, like all heart valves, opens to let blood go through and then closes. As we get older, most of us do get some stiffness in that aortic valve. So instead of opening all the way, it only opens maybe three quarters of the way. Some people, and we really don't know why certain people get it and certain people don't get it, it only opens a small amount. And so we call this condition aortic stenosis. It's basically a stiffness of the leaflets such that the leaflets of the valve don't open properly. And once it gets severe, it's really life-threatening. So for the last 45 years, since the 60s, you had two choices. You could either do nothing and take your chances, or you can have open surgery, open heart surgery. Now, I'm 49. If you're a 49 healthy person, you usually will fly through open heart surgery with really a small degree of likelihood that you're going to have something bad happen to you. But what if you're 85 and you've got bad lungs and bad kidneys? Those people are not good candidates for open heart surgery. So this TAVR procedure has given us a third option that we can say to patients, we can do nothing and hope for the best. We can do major open heart surgery, or we can do this new, it's kind of a minimally invasive procedure where my partners can go up through the groin and actually do this procedure through the groin. It is done in a special type of cath lab operating room. It's almost kind of like a hybrid kind of thing where a cath lab is where we do cardiology procedures, an operating room is where they do surgery. And it's actually done by both cardiologists like myself and heart surgeons. And it really works. This was invented about 10 years ago. And a big study came out about 4 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, that showed that it worked. And then about 2 or 3 years ago, it became approved. But it's only approved for the highest risk people. It's only approved for people that would not survive standard open heart surgery. The government and the insurance industry has basically put very strict guidelines in as to who can get this minimally invasive procedure. And the funny thing,
but
Dave,
it is covered by insurance if they meet the requirements.
Yes.
Okay.
But so I've had maybe 4 or 5 patients that are maybe in their 80s, but they're, you know, pretty healthy 80-year-olds. And they've actually said to me, I've had this scenario happen for, I see a lot of patients, Dave. So I've had kind of at least one or two of every scenario. But in the last year or so, I've had 4 or 5 different patients who have severe aortic stenosis. The valve barely opens and they're getting symptoms. They're getting tightness in the chest or shortness of breath. In other words, it's time to make our move. It's time to fish or cut bait. We got to fix that valve. And I've had 4 or 5 of them say, Dr. Waxler, I will not have open heart surgery. If I can have that minimally invasive surgery, I'll do it. And they got turned down because they were too healthy. So the funny thing about this new procedure is It's only reserved for the sickest of the sick people that A, desperately need the procedure or they'll die, and B, won't survive the surgery. Funny enough, what came up in Chicago just a week ago is there was a large study of people that are said to be at moderate risk. Remember what I said a moment ago, until now, the only people that can have this new procedure, it's relatively new procedure, are the people that are the sickest of the sick at really high risk. They just published a study, it just came out a week ago, showing that patients at moderate risk, so people that are a little bit on the sick side, do better if they get the TAVR procedure.
Better than the open heart surgery?
At least as well, if not better than open heart. At least as well as open heart. And so what I think is going to happen, there's always a few month delay. You made the point already that just when a study comes out doesn't mean the FDA has approved it.
Right.
I think it's probably going to take a few months, but my prediction is they're going to open up the, not open up the floodgates, I don't want to exaggerate, but they're going to expand the guidelines, the criteria, such that more people can get this TAVR. So somebody that a year ago may have been said to be too healthy, if 6 months from now we try again, they'll probably get it. So it's pretty exciting stuff. So for those of you out there who have something called aortic stenosis, which is a narrowing of your aortic valve, or you know somebody who has it, but maybe that person's in their 70s or 80s and who says, forget it, I don't want that open heart surgery. There's a chance that we might be able to get you this relatively new, it's not brand new, relatively new, minimally invasive procedure called TAVR. My group, the Berks Cardiology Group, goes to both hospitals. We go to St. Joe's and Reading. We started the program at St. Joe's about 3 years ago, and the Reading program started about 2 years ago. I don't know off the top of my head how many have been done, but I can tell you the guy in my group who does them at St. Joe's, a guy named Pagheri, has the best hands I've seen. He's very, very, very good. And I would let him do that procedure on me or my family. It's a relatively safe procedure. It is a heart procedure. So there is a 1 or 2% risk of bad things happening. But the risk is in single digits. And most likely you go home in 3 to 4 days, and within a couple of weeks you're good as new. It's really a pretty neat procedure.
So basically, they're going to be in the hospital 3 to 4 days.
Something like that. So it is a surgery, and they do use general anesthesia. And I think people are going home on either day 3 or day 4. Whereas traditional open heart surgery, you're going home on like day 6 or day 7.
3 to 4 weeks, they're back doing whatever they were doing
pretty
before.
Much.
And then some.
Yeah.
They should be doing more because of the procedure.
Yeah. So the exciting, yes, the answer is absolutely. The exciting thing about this, this study that came out in Chicago is I believe that this is going to be really compelling evidence that we're going to have to open up the expand the criteria. I have nothing to do with it. I'm just making a prediction, but I suspect that's what's going to happen. A couple other things that were interesting.
Who's going to make the final decision on opening this up? Is that going to be up to the insurance company,
the FDA? The FDA and Medicare. Most of these patients are Medicare patients because probably 99% of people that have aortic stenosis are over the age of 65. So this is really going to be a Medicare issue.
But by the same token, if someone is younger and they want to pay for it, they can get it done provided they want to pay for it.
I don't know about that. I don't know if you can just write a check for it. It's probably like $50,000. It's probably a big check.
I'm not questioning that, but for someone who's got those kind of bucks.
Probably. I mean, I suppose. I don't know the answer to that, Dave. I suppose if you met with the CEO of St. Joe's and said, I want to write you a check and do this, I'm sure he would say, okay. In other words, I've never thought of that scenario, but I suppose that could happen.
I mean, because right now we're looking at a situation where if the insurance company doesn't okay it, then it doesn't get done.
Right.
So they're not even going to the insurance company.
Right now, Dave, it's not even an insurance company issue. It's actually the government is really restricting this to specific patients. So I don't know if a doctor could do this off protocol. In other words, it's my understanding, I don't do the procedure. So
right. For
those of you out there who are thinking, how come you don't know the answer to this question? I just see patients in the office and I know about the procedure, but I don't, I've never done the paperwork to get a person a procedure. But it's my understanding that 100% of the patients have to be, you know, fit the criteria that the government has set forth. And so I don't know if somebody who's really, really rich could just say, I want that. I don't know if that's possible. I'm the wrong guy. Either way, that's kind of an unusual situation. The point is that I think that this is going to be available to more people. And, you know, you only have to be sort of moderately sick. You don't have to be sort of dreadfully sick to get this.
As a layman and not a doctor, the procedure is already approved by the FDA.
Yes.
But it sounds like it's only approved for people who meet certain criteria.
That's correct. That is exactly how it's approved.
So it almost sounds like even if someone comes in with a blank check and wants it done, they're not going to meet
I don't think the FDA
approval and criteria to have the procedure done. Therefore, they probably can't get it in this country.
You're probably correct. Maybe they have to go to another country. But
I mean, I'm not trying to hang you out to dry.
No,
I'm just
trying
to understand a little bit better on this.
No, I think that is correct. But let's move on to talk about what else. So some other interesting stuff that came out in Chicago. There's this whole new family of drugs, and we've talked about this before, called, you ready? This is a mouthful, PCSK9 inhibitors. PCSK9 inhibitors. Basically what those are is it's a new category of cholesterol-lowering medications that were invented about 10 years ago. But they've been in under research protocol. In other words, they've only been available for less than a year, about 8 or 9 months. There are two of them that are FDA approved. The last 3 or 4 years, there have been large-scale, multi-center studies with hundreds, if not thousands, of patients. And my group, it was involved in a lot of the studies of one of them. One of the drugs is called Praluent. It's made by a company called Sanofi and Regeneron. Sanofi and Regeneron are two separate companies that work together to make this drug. A second drug is called Repatha. It's made by Amgen. Those are both FDA approved. These medications are to be used in addition to statins. We've talked about statins before. Statins are Crestor, Lipitor, Zocor, and the generics end in statin. So the Lipitor went generic 2 years ago. It's called atorvastatin. Zocor went generic about 4 years ago. It's called simvastatin. There's one called pravastatin, lovastatin. Statins have been around since about 1987. Everybody just about who's had atherosclerosis, which means hardening of the arteries, or diabetes should be on a statin. I have neither of those two, and I take a statin. Most cardiologists take a statin. But there are situations where people need either something in addition to the statin, or patients say to me all the time, I can't take a statin. I can't tolerate a statin. I've tried 3 or 4 different ones, and my body doesn't tolerate it. So this new category of medicine was invented really for two types of people. People that have such severe high cholesterol, Dave, their cholesterol is so incredibly high that even on a statin, their numbers are still terrible. And I have a few of those. Hmm. Or the second category of people is people that really desperately need to be on a statin, but they've been on 3 or 4 and they just can't take it. So these new medicines are wonderful. They're called PCSK9 inhibitors. They're not pills. They're little injections under the skin. We call it sub-Q or subcutaneous. That's a little tiny injection like a mosquito bite under the skin. It doesn't even hurt. You barely even notice it's there every 2 weeks. And people can give themselves an injection. These companies are brilliant. They design these pens, these little pens that literally, I'm not kidding, a first grader can use. You just swab a little spot on your tummy with alcohol and you hold this pen up against your tummy and you push a button and count to 10 and that's it and you're done once every 2 weeks. The problem, of course, is the same problem with all new drugs, Dave. They're going to be expensive as heck. And so the insurance companies are now negotiating whether they're going to cover it or not. If you have to pay out of pocket, you're in big trouble. These are like $1,000 a month. So nobody can, unless you're incredibly wealthy, the average person cannot pay out of pocket. Some insurance companies are making it like a tier 2 or a tier 3, so it's like $40 a month or something that's reasonable, and some aren't. So it kind of comes down to luck whether or not your insurance company will cover it, whether you can afford it. But what came out in Chicago, these two drugs that I mentioned have been around about 9 months now. And there's a third one in the pipeline that's from the company called Pfizer. Pfizer has one that'll probably be approved in 6 months. And this is not insider trading, this is public knowledge. But there were some studies that came out in Chicago that continue to show that these drugs work and they appear to save lives. So the early evidence, we're going to get more evidence in about a year or so, but the early evidence appears to suggest that there's a lower risk of heart attack and stroke and death. I think that'll be proven more definitively within the next year or so. So these are great drugs. One's called Praluent, one's called Repatha. The people that are candidates for these drugs are people that have super, super, super high cholesterol, and it's still terrible even on a statin, or people that desperately need to be on a statin. People with bad hardening of the arteries, or even moderate hardening of the arteries, and some people with diabetes and high cholesterol, and who can't take a statin. If that sounds like you, you know, I can tell you, you can give us a call and we can tell you if you qualify for one of these new drugs. The key is gonna be, see if your insurance company will pay for it, because it's awful expensive. But in Chicago, there were some studies that show that this is pretty beneficial.
And these are used with a statin or instead of a statin, or either one?
So the only time you can use it instead of a statin is somebody who can't tolerate a statin. So you can't just choose to use it instead of a statin. So it's used with a statin or in people that are intolerant of statins. But people can't say, I'd rather have that than a statin. The insurance company's going to say no. Then you are paying out of pocket.
So, but the insurance company, if you've got the right insurance company, will cover this even if you're on a statin. They'll cover the statin and this.
Yes.
Depending on the insurance
company.
Every
statin except one is now generic. So it's the insurance companies, it's easy for them to, quote, cover a statin because they're cheap. Crestor is the only statin that's still brand name, and that's going to go generic in literally about 3 months, sort of mid to late summer. So for those of you on Crestor out there, help is coming. The price will be dropping at some point. All the other statins are generic. So if you're on Crestor and you can't afford it, call your doctor and ask if you could be possibly switched to generic Lipitor, which is called atorvastatin. Or hang in there, the Crestor price is going to come down. And the people that sell Crestor, AstraZeneca, they're now giving out discount cards. We have some discount cards in our office, call Waxler, the Berks Cardiology office. The company that makes Crestor is giving out these cards that makes it cheaper. So the good news is for statins, they're affordable now. These PCSK9 inhibitors are not, but you know, hopefully you get some help from the insurance companies.
Okay, but basically, if they're a patient of Berks Cardiologist now, they could actually just call in and say, hey, would this be something that I should be taking?
Correct.
They don't have to
start from scratch.
They could call in, talk to you or whomever, whoever they normally talk to.
We could look through their chart. We could tell within like 3 minutes, just looking at their chart, whether or not they would be somebody who would benefit from one of these new drugs. Then we'd bring them into the office to really talk about it, you know, in detail.
Right, but if you look at their chart and say, no, this isn't going to work for you, or you don't qualify for whatever reason, you're not going to drag them into the office to discuss it more.
So No.
They're not trying to take your money. Feel free to call
believe
in.
My next appointment is the last week of May. And I'm not saying that, you know, look out. I'm not saying that to be a big shot. I'm just saying that you know, we don't need to waste your time for unnecessary appointments. So believe me, we have a lot of sick people who need to be seen. We don't want to waste anybody's time. The point is, though, you may qualify for this. A third thing that was kind of interesting that came out in some of the smaller announcements of the cardiology meeting, there's a new blood test called the CORUS, C-O-R-U-S, C-O-R-U-S blood test. It's been out about a year. It's an interesting blood test, and ironically, we were part of the research. We were one of probably 50 or 100 different locations 4 or 5 years ago that participated in some of this research that led to this blood test. This blood test is now FDA approved. It is official. It's approved. It's covered by most insurances. It's a very interesting blood test in the sense that it's the first of its kind. I've been a doctor since 1992. I've been a cardiologist since 1995. So in my 20 plus years, I have never heard of any blood test like this. It's the first blood test of its kind that actually is a marker for hardening of the arteries, atherosclerosis. We've had for years, you know, blood tests to look at your cholesterol. Starting about 15 years ago, we had a blood test called the CRP. Some of you may have heard of that, C-reactive protein. C-reactive protein is a marker of inflammation. If your CRP is high, that means you're at risk for coronary disease. But this blood test actually gives you an idea of how much hardening of the arteries, atherosclerosis, you have. And if it's high, you may have a problem. If it's low, you're golden. The study shows, Dave, that a low blood test, a low chorus blood test, gives you a 96 to 97% likelihood that you don't have significant blockage. That's pretty darn, that's better than any stress test. Let me say that again. A low chorus, C-O-R-U-S blood test, if yours comes back really low, you are 96 to 97% out of the woods, and that's better than a stress test. Now, if it comes back high, you probably have a problem. My problem with this blood test is every once in a while I get one in the middle, and then I have to confess to you, I have no idea what to do. I say to the patient, I go, now, you know, so me and the patient have to kind of figure out now what do we do. But this is a cool blood test. It's only been out about a year. I sort of discovered it about 6 months ago. And I've used it a few times. It is covered by some insurances. It's not covered by other insurances. I've been told by the company that if it's not covered, if you have no insurance, or if it's, you have an insurance that doesn't cover it, the most the company will charge you is $195. Now, that's still a lot of money. I'm not saying that's cheap. But I'm saying I think it's, you know, it costs the company more than that. But I think they'll try to cut you a break.
Who should have this test done?
People that have unexplained, good question, unexplained chest discomfort or unexplained shortness of breath. You can't, at this point, you can't get the blood test if you have no symptoms. In other words, if you say to me, Dave,
I'd say, hey, let me go take this test and see what's going on.
I want to get this blood test.
Yeah.
You have to have a symptom. It can be chest discomfort. It can be shortness of breath. You can't just say, I just want to take the test. If you have chest discomfort or shortness of breath, we can get you this blood test at the Berks Cardiology office. And like I said, several insurances do cover it and some don't. The ones that don't, the company tells me, I don't work for the company, but I understand from the company rep that it may cost you $195, but they told me that if you're below a certain income, if you're really, you know, impoverished, if you really don't have any money, it's free. So the point is, it may be free depending on your insurance and your income. It may cost you $195, but it's something to consider. And it is pretty helpful. Like I said, if it comes back in the middle, then, you know, what do I don't know what to do with that. But if it comes back very high, it's helpful. If it comes back very low, it's helpful. Real quick, I have a patient who passed his stress tests are pretty good. Stress tests are pretty good. They're about 85% accurate. I have a guy who I was really worried about, and he passed his stress test. And he was having chest discomfort. And everybody in his family has coronary disease. And I said, let's get this blood test, and hopefully it'll be negative, and then I can tell you you're fine. It was high, Dave. The guy had a 95% blockage in the Widowmaker artery. So this blood test really saved one of my patients.
So his stress test turned out
his stress test was normal, which is scary. But remember, stress tests are 85% accurate. Remember, Dave's a baseball fan. If you have something that's 30% accurate, that's the same thing as batting 300, you go to the Hall of Fame. So in baseball, if you're 30% accurate, you're in the Hall of Fame.
If you're a weatherman and you're 10% accurate, they think you're doing well.
You go to the Hall of Fame. So stress tests are 85% accurate. I think that's pretty good, but this chorus blood test, if it's low, it's 97% accurate. So a couple of interesting things. So if you have any questions, you can always call Dr. Waxler at the Berks Cardiology Office, 610-685-8500, Waxler. But interesting things. One of the things I love about cardiology is you're a full-time student. There's always new things. We're always learning. There's always new science, new techniques. It's a very exciting field because we're trying to keep people like you and me alive, Dave.
And we are trying to keep you, our viewers, up to date on the new stuff, as we just told you about it tonight. So remember, this chorus blood test, if you've got the symptoms, or if they've had a stress test before, then they would qualify for this also.
Absolutely.
And use this chorus blood test to go good or bad based on how the stress test turned out.
Absolutely.
Okay, great.
And go Eagles. We need a good draft in a couple weeks. I'm thinking Ezekiel Elliott, and he's an Atlanta Braves fan. We need the Phillies to beat the Braves this year, but it shouldn't be a problem.
Thanks again, as always. Again, Dr. Andy Waxler, I'm Dave Spector. We'll see you again in 2 months. You all have a good spring.